In entertainment, an all-Filipino musical is set to make its debut in Manitoba this summer. Take a look.
One by one, cast members of the newest musical to hit Rainbow Stage this summer were presented at a media event in Winnipeg. They are made up of 22 performers, as well as a team of hip-hop choreographers and wardrobe managers, all Filipino. Musical theater company Rainbow Stage says this is the first time in its 70 years of operation that it commissioned and developed a musical. Mabuhay is a hilarious musical filled with original pop music and hip-hop dance. It is set against the backdrop of a fictional Filipino reality TV competition.
It's a true dream come true. I've been working on this project for the last 7 years. It has been an up-road battle to get here, but it was worth it to put all my blood, sweat, and tears so that I can feature this many Filipinos on the professional stage, on the Canadian stage, as well as get them paid for their talents.
Joseph Sevillo, who has been working in theater for 20 years, believes the musical is not just a story of Filipinos, but also of everyone who bravely goes on a journey to find themselves and realize their dreams.
It's about one's journey, about finding themselves in pursuit of their dreams. And I think that every human being has a dream, and on that journey to pursuing that dream, they find themselves. And that's a universal message. So I hope that everyone, when they watch the show, they leave inspired to pursue their own dreams.
Joining the cast is Andrea Makasait, who is making a name for herself in Broadway and is best known for originating the role of Anne Boleyn in Six. She was also a part of Mabuhay in its early stages of development.
What an honor it is to be able to put up a show built off of love, passion, and drive to be heard, to be seen, and to take up space within this country.
Also in attendance was Joy Lazo, herself a pioneer on the professional stage and a vocal coach to many young Manitoba.
It's also a good opportunity for our Filipino talents to be featured because we have been underrepresented for so long. And so it's really a big takeoff for these talents, and hopefully it will inspire a lot of our local talents here to, you know, hone and be involved more.
Sevillo says his dream is for the musical to someday reach Broadway.
The dream has always been the furthest reach, which was New York on Broadway. I want it to not only be the first Filipino musical from Manitoba, which it is now, but I want it to be the first musical from Manitoba to land on Broadway, which is a big feat, but I gotta keep going with that.
Mabuhay, a new musical, will have its world premiere on Rainbow Stage from June 26 to July 14. Lucille Nolasco Garrido, ABS-CBN News, Winnipeg.
A Filipino-American brings a taste of Filipino coffee to the U.S. state of Georgia. More in this report.
Okay, so before it's roasted, coffee looks like this. This is the seed of a coffee cherry from a coffee plant.
Jonathan Pasquale is brewing something special. His second coffee shop in Georgia. This one he calls Opo. Serves coffee with respect, he says. Taproom Coffee and Beer Bar in Atlanta was the Filipino-American's first venture. But what sets Opo Coffee Shop apart from the others in the area is its coffee training lab. It's the only one in the Atlanta metro area that offers Specialty Coffee Association certificates. And this, a roastery.
So this cooks it, roasts it, and then this is a big cooling tray. And then once it's in this cooling tray and cooled down, we can bag it up, and then it's ready for someone to purchase or for us to grind and brew at our coffee bar.
And for the first time, Pasquale is offering specialty coffee from the Philippines, Mount Apo Coffee from Davao del Sur province. It's not an easy task, he says, considering supply chain issues and lack of demand.
We're going to help to pioneer that. We're going to be one of the ones that starts building that customer base so that on this side, we grow the demand.
Pasquale shares getting this sack of Mount Apo coffee to Georgia took some time and a lot of groundwork.
You have there the cooperative who's selling it. They're selling it maybe to an intermediary per se.
They are working with one importer here that we're working with in New Orleans. She's purchasing their coffee, working out the logistics of exporting from there, importing here, storing it in a facility in New Orleans. And then when we purchase it, we buy it from there, they ship it to us here in Atlanta, and they come in the big sacks of 60 kilos.
According to the United States Department of Agriculture, America imports the majority of its coffee from Brazil and Colombia. Pasquale is hoping he could help change that, one sip of Mount Apo coffee at a time. Len Amadine Thornhill, ABS-CBN News, Decatur, Georgia.
Feeling thirsty for the Word of God, but also for a pint of beer? If yes, this establishment in northern Spain is perfect for you. A congregation of Catholic nuns has reopened a bar at an 11th century Roman sanctuary, coinciding with the start of Holy Week. The sisters took over operations from its previous owners, Benedictine monks, who had let a local association run the bar. And from early accounts, the business has experienced a miraculous revival. The White House not seeing indications of an Israeli invasion in Rafah in the coming days. White House National Security Advisor John Kirby also reiterated Washington's position that a major ground operation in Rafah is not the right course of action. Israel is planning a Rafah offensive, saying it's Hamas's last major stronghold in the Gaza Strip. But over a million Palestinians forced out of their homes by the war have sought shelter there.
In terms of timing, it seems like they're a ways off here from actually moving into Rafah. That said, does the president feel a sense of urgency about the suffering in Gaza? Absolutely, which is why we've been pushing so hard to get additional crossings open, get more trucks in, even while we're negotiating for a hostage deal, still trying to do everything we can to improve the humanitarian situation on the ground, continuing to do airdrops. We don't believe that a major ground operation in Rafah is the right course of action, particularly when you have 1.5 million people there seeking refuge and no conceived plan, no verifiable plan to take care of them. We've been very consistent on that.
Israel not taking the move of the U.S. lightly. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu canceled a visit of high-level delegation to Washington after the U.S. stood aside and allowed UN ceasefire resolution to pass. Now, Netanyahu says the U.S. failing to veto the deal was a clear retreat from its previous position. The Israeli delegation was due to discuss a planned military operation in Rafah. The U.S. reportedly considers Israel's decision an overreaction.
So it is a bit surprising and unfortunate that they're not going to apparently attend these meetings because, as you heard the secretary say in Tel Aviv on Friday after he met with Prime Minister Netanyahu and other members of the Israeli government, we believe that, number one, a full-scale invasion of Rafah would be a mistake. It would be a mistake not just because of the civilian harm that it would cause, which would be immense.
As for Israel, its defense minister insists it could not end the war while there are still hostages in Gaza. So after months of impasse, the United Nations Security Council passes a resolution demanding an immediate ceasefire in Gaza. The deal was reached after the U.S. abstained from the vote. The remaining 14 council members voted in favor of the resolution, which also calls for the immediate and unconditional release of all hostages held by Hamas.
This must be a turning point. This must lead to saving lives on the ground. This must signal the end of this assault of atrocities against our people. A nation is being murdered. A nation is being dispossessed. A nation is being displaced for decades now, but never at this scale since the Nakba.
Now, Washington had been averse to the word ceasefire in the nearly six-month-old war, which has already killed over 32,000 Palestinians. It previously used its veto power three times to reject a truce. But as famine looms in Gaza and global pressure for a truce grows, the U.S. changed its tune.
We appreciated the willingness of members of this council to take some of our edits and improve on this resolution. Still, certain key edits were ignored, including our request to add a condemnation of Hamas. and we did not agree with everything in the resolution. For that reason, we were unfortunately not able to vote yes. However, as I've said before, we fully support some of the critical objectives in this non-binding resolution, and we believe it was important for the Council to speak out and make clear that our ceasefire must, any ceasefire, must come with the release of all hostages.
The UN says Security Council resolutions are as binding as international laws. Now on X, UN Chief Antonio Guterres lauded the approval of the resolution, saying failure to implement it would be unforgivable. Russian President Vladimir Putin again linking Ukraine to last week's deadly concert hall attack as the death toll climbs to 139. Putin says while radical Islamists were behind the shootings, the attack fits into a wider campaign of intimidation by Kyiv.
It is absolutely clear that the terrible crime committed on March 22 in the capital of Russia, this is an act of intimidation, as I already said. And immediately a question arises, who benefits from this? This atrocity may be just a link in a whole series of attempts by those who have been at war with our country since 2014, by the hands of the neo-Nazi Kyiv regime. And the Nazis, as is well known, have never hesitated to use the dirtiest and most inhumane means to achieve their goals.
Now, France has joined the U.S. in saying intelligence indicated the Islamic State was responsible for the attack. French President Emmanuel Macron also saying the gunmen in the Moscow attack were part of the ISIS branch that was behind foiled attempts to attack France over the past few months. Former U.S. President Donald Trump has succeeded in his bid to pause his $54 million civil fraud judgment. A mid-level state court ruled New York authorities cannot take steps to seize Trump's assets if he posts a smaller $175 million bond within days. Now, the ruling delays the enforcement of a judgment in a case that found he overstated his wealth to dupe investors and lenders.
Greatly respect the decision of the appellate division, and we will abide by that. We'll put up cash or bond very quickly, securities, cash or bond, whatever it is, we'll put it up very quickly, and we'll win the case.
Meanwhile, Trump's trial on charges stemming from hush money paid to adult film actress Stormy Daniels is set to begin on April 15. A judge dismissed Trump's appeal to delay the criminal trial.